Welcome to SSI Meetup. Today we will be talking about a new funding mechanism that has been created by the European Union to push forward the SSI movement across the European Union. I'm really happy about this. This is one of the two initiatives that exist from the European Union with a very similar name. One is the European SSI Framework, and one is the European SSI Framework Lab, which is what will be presented today by Oscar and Riks from TNO. TNO, if you don't know it already, is one of the leading research groups in the Netherlands. It's a public-private institution. Riks and Oscar will be able to tell us a little bit more about this too. Riks and Oscar, they're both leaders of the SSI community. They're very active. They're also part of the Self-Sovereign Identity book that we're writing. And both of them, together with Thurman, they've written the second chapter of the Self-Sovereign Identity book that we'll be publishing with Manning. And today they will be talking about the ESSIF lab. And I'm really happy about this, as I said, because I think it's one of the most important initiatives that I've seen globally to push SSI in a specific region, and it's encouraging to see that the European Union is taking such a strong stance with this. And as we're seeing right now in this very special circumstances that we have right now with the COVID-19, it's something that that is really needed in this new world that is coming up. So in the next slide, let me quickly introduce to you what SSI Meetup is about, in case you don't know it already. We've been running for 2 years. This is webinar number 52, but we recorded another one last week, which was 53. So we have 53 webinars in total where you can learn about SSI, self-sovereign identity, decentralized digital identity. It's open to everyone. If you're a private person, organization, association, whatever it is, you can reuse this material. It has a Creative Commons by share-like license, which basically means that you can reuse this material across the world. This is happening very actively. They're using all this material in all continents. You will have access to the Google slide deck the same way you see it right now. And the only thing you have to do is, if you use it, please to give credit back to the creators, which today is ESSIF Lab, Oscar and Riks, who are leading this. And also please to SSI Meetup, and you can of course also reuse all the other material that we've been creating so far. If you have any questions, if they're relevant to the concrete slide where Riks and Oscar will be talking, then I'll be sharing those questions with Oscar and Riks. If not, we're just going to leave all those questions for the end. By the way, this has been our most popular webinar ever so far in terms of signups. So I'm really happy that people are showing so much interest in the subject for the European Union. And without further ado, it will be Riks who will be presenting first, and Oscar will be taking over then. We will do a little switch in terms of screen sharing, and welcome Riks in presenting ESSILF at SSI Meetup today. Thank you.
Yes, thank you very much, Alex. We are very happy to have been provided this opportunity to do this webinar on ESSIF Lab. So thank you. You already mentioned that there is ESSIF and there is ESSIF Lab. Both are initiatives somehow related to the European Union. ESSIF is a project where the European Union tries to create a European blockchain infrastructure services, that is EPSI, called EPSI. And one of the things they need on top of that is identity, and they try to use the self-sovereign identity for that. And in this effort that is run directly by the European Union, that framework that they're using there is ESSIF, and it's really blockchain oriented. ESSIF Lab is a European project that is basically doing some different things, and it's also organized differently. And the organization and everything, that is something that Oscar van Deventer will be talking about. And I will be starting to provide with the vision of ESSIF Lab, basically saying what it is we would like to achieve. So when we are talking self-sovereign identity, then what is that? Basically, it's like the elephant metaphor, and depending on who you're talking to, you get other stories, you get other definitions. And from the SF Lab perspective, we don't really care what the definition of SSI is, as you will see. Also, people make lots of assumptions on or are concerned about privacy and things like that. And they say SSI has to mitigate these privacy concerns. Perhaps we don't object to that, but it's not our core business. So what is our core business? That is precisely this, that is facilitating transactions, business transactions, if you will, in an electronic fashion. That is what we are actually doing. So what is a business transaction? Basically, business transactions come in many forms, and I use the term business transaction rather than transaction because we are not specifically going into a blockchain where a transaction has a particular meaning. So to distinguish from blockchain transaction, I use the word business transaction, but for me, transaction and business transaction is the same thing. So basically, a transaction means that somebody issues a request, for example, for a parking permit, and that means that you have to provide information. Typically, that would electronically be done in a web form that has to be filled in, and it has to be filled in just by typing, or you may need to upload PDFs or other documentation. And while this is a parking permit example in the public arena, you also have lots of these examples, of course, in finance, health, education, and so on. So applying for something and filling in the form and uploading the PDFs is step one. Step two is that somebody at the other end needs to validate this data. And by validation, I mean determining whether or not the data that has been provided is valid, is useful to decide whether or not to actually honor the request. So it's only about truth, insofar truth is relevant for making this decision. But basically, it is, does it come from the right source? Do I trust it? Is the uncertainty with which that I can gather from this data, is that sufficient for me to actually use it in deciding whether or not to provide this parking permit? So validation depends largely on the kind of business transaction that is being negotiated. Validation is also not actually making this decision. Is basically forms go into a store, and they may also be enriched with data that comes from other IT systems, and that makes the complete data for somebody to actually grant or reject the application. So this is what we are actually talking about. Now, this seems very simple, but it really is not. Users have lots of complaints, and I have a few of them here. Some people do not understand a form, for example, a yearly income. If that were to be asked, what is the yearly income? Is that before taxes or after taxes? Does it include vacation benefits and other stuff? That's usually not all that obvious. And that is just something that everybody has experience with, this yearly salary. And there is lots of other misunderstandings in forms. The next thing is, if you know what the data is, where do you get it? Do you get, for example, your yearly salary? Do you get it from your tax office, or do you get it from your employer or from your bank? Where do you get it? Sometimes you have to go physically somewhere. For example, if you are applying for a wheelchair, you may need to get an attestation from your physical doctor, your MD, or whatever it's called. And he actually has to sign a paper saying that you don't have legs anymore or something like that. And with this attestation, which you then have to scan and upload and stuff like that, then you can use that for your application of your wheelchair. But you have to go somewhere, which in the case of not having legs may be difficult. Then the last thing or something is data may not, the data you provide, you may be quite unsure about whether or not it is good enough. And if you're unsure, then that gives a lousy feeling. Some people say, well, this is lots of bureaucratic things. My situation is very much simpler than everything they want to know. And some people also say, well, I'm being asked so many things and I don't know all this, I just simply give up. So there are lots of problems in filling in these forms. And we can see there is a some research with the Dutch National Ombudsman that states that these difficulties in simply filling in forms cause a societal divide where citizens that are incapable of completing forms because of the things I just mentioned do not apply for benefits that they are entitled to and that they actually need. And since they don't apply, they don't get them. And that is a big problem. And at least in our government, that is what they see, and they really want to do something about it. On the other side, there are also many challenges. First of all, you have these people that need to do this validation, and you need to instruct them. Business has to provide instructions for them to validate these documents. How can you support them with IT? They may need to check some of the data in there. What's the fallback? Validators, when they are human, they can make mistakes. How do you control the cost of validation? And that's really costly. People have been estimating that it is 1 billion euros in the Netherlands alone for validation costs of forms. So this is really big money. And the question for the businesses is basically, do you pay the price of validation or do you not validate and just run the risk of making a decision with invalid data? So this is basically the playing field that we are in. And now imagine that you have this digital vault and everybody that is familiar with SSI knows about this digital vault wallet. And we put in everything. Oh, this, we put everything in here. Somehow the visuals didn't work here. Should have been all in there. And then we make it digital. So now we have the same form, but we have this digital wallet. And then we provide a QR code on the form, but that does not work either, the visual. I'm sorry for that. It should have been on the form. And then the app can scan the QR code, and then it can connect to this little robot, the equivalent of the human validator. That will be the electronic validator that can access the form. So for reading the QR code, the app can communicate with this validator that knows about the form, and then they can exchange electronically what the form is, what data are needed, who the parties are that should be attesting to this data, etc. The app can then look all this data up in the electronic vault that it has and provide the information to the robot, who can then check the provenance, who has issued it, and check whether or not it has been tampered with these credentials. And if that all checks out, it can take out the stuff that it needs and fill in the form. And then things go on as usual. So basically, we're adding an electronic channel for filling in the forms. That's one of the the one-liner that we use to say to explain to people, what is SSI, what according to you? then we say it's an electronic means, an electronic assistance for filling in forms. Okay, obviously you can, when storing these forms into a database for further processing, you no longer need perhaps to enrich it by making IT links to other systems, because these other systems can issue credentials or attestations into your secure wallet, and then you can just ask them by the form and not do that in the back office. So IT connections can be reduced as well. That's a nice benefit. So this is an overview of some of the benefits that we see on the user. That's the inclusivity. People need not know how to fill in the forms, at least for the part that is being dealt with electronically. There's an improved speed, obviously. You don't have to physically go places because everything can be attested to electronically, and it's a lot easier and faster, of course. And frustration for filling in forms is minimized. At the organizational side, this is a way to actually get quality data. Many organizations want quality data. This is a way to get that. The validation is easy. You can do that electronically for credentials that have been provided electronically. You have a higher satisfaction of the customer or the citizen, depending on who you are as an organization. You have higher filling in success rates. You can do away with IT links, or at least some of them. If the protocols are going to support that, then GDPR support can be built in as well to a large extent. And there are new business opportunities. So, how do we want to organize this? Well, we need to organize this in two ways. The first way is organizing an infrastructure, a technical infrastructure, an objective interoperable technology, if you will. The objective means that you can actually use algorithms, math, and all this other stuff that do not depend on particular parties being involved. It's the same for everyone. We need some interoperable technical components, some functionalities like apps, agents, wallets. And these components are there for the exchange of credentials, attestations in various forms, not just verifiable credentials the W3C is doing, but also X509 attribute certificates, attribute-based credentials, all sorts of other stuff. And this exchanging of credentials should go over secure connections, traditionally SSL, but perhaps also Bitcoin. And these components should also have connections to web servers, because of course the legacy, the business stuff needs to be using this infrastructure, and we need to go to do away with all these difficult logins. So that's infrastructure, and that is the same for everyone. On the other side, we have the subjective information processes, and that is different for everyone. So where we do the infrastructure collectively, business cases and actually profiting from the benefits is an individual thing. And every party, every individual, enterprise, government, or regardless of the vertical it is in, must think on its own in a self-sovereign way. That's what we see as self-sovereign, that is that you can do things your own way, about the online transactions that you want to participate in, and you must self-sovereignly decide about what business rules, what policies you have for committing, what data you need to mitigate the risk of transactions going sour, etc. And then you have to establish your processes for integrating SSI in a way that is subjective for your business. And you have to create your own business cases for driving the adoption and transformation of this new way of working. So there is lots of stuff that we can do in these various realms. In the business, if you look in the subjective business-oriented realm, then in order to decide whether or not you can actually ask for specific credentials, what it means when you get a credential and stuff like that, you need a catalog because credentials are basically the same thing as the building blocks or the screws and the bolts with which you construct a transaction. And you need to know what the specific credentials can do for you. And then obviously you have a yellow pages service. You need to be able to find these credentials in meaningful groups. We will need some technology that plug in into web shops, for example. You can read for yourself, and it's also in the text for the calls that SF Lab is issuing. But in the business, there is lots of stuff that can actually be done to help further self-sovereign identity. Then at the technical infrastructure oriented thing, that's where people tend to feel more at home. Of course, we need the secure credential storages, the wallets or the hubs or whatever they are called. We need apps and browser add-ons to work with different kinds of credentials, not just verifiable credentials or ABCs, but also the X509 certificates so that we can accommodate the technology that exists in the more traditional businesses. We may need some web proxies that implement or connect with components, with the various components, because this is going to be quite a complex thing. We may need the revocation services. Of course, there are already several revocation services, but you may also need a revocation service for a credential after it has been presented. And I'm not aware of privacy preserving revocation services that can do that, etc. Also at the technical infra level, lots of opportunities are there to contribute. And everything, of course, somehow has to become interoperable. It has to become scalable, and that is because it's going to need to be a worldwide infrastructure. That is, if I have anything to say about that. And now let's give Oscar his time. Unless there are any, no. Let's Oscar.
Hello, I'm Oscar van Deventer, and I'll move on from here. Just checking, Alex, you can see my screen, correct?
I can see your screen, correct? Yes.
Okay, so Rix has told you a lot about our technical ambition, and I'm going to tell you a bit how we are organizing this. So on this sheet, you see a bunch of numbers. The European Union, the next generation internet group has granted us some money, and we are responsible of subgranting it to some of you. Just you see the numbers. We have an infrastructure open call, which is already open. It has a total of 3.1 million euro subgrants and a maximum of 105,000 euro per subgrantee. But of course, not all subgrantees will get the maximum, only the ones that make it all the way to the end of the project. For the first business open call, there is a total grant amount of almost 1.3 million euro. This grant has also opened. It will have its deadline 1 month from now, and it has a maximum of 106,000 euro per subgrantee. And the second business open call will open, I think it's later this year or early next year. I need to check that. But anyway, that's more future. So in the infrastructure open call, we will work together on open source stuff, whereas in the business open calls, we will be developing products and services. And for the business open calls, the technical and business mentoring is offered. So if you're an SME or a startup and business mentoring would be useful, for instance, improving your elevator pitch, getting you in contact with investors, that is also part of this work. So on the next slide, this illustrates how the three different types of calls are connected. So starting again with the infrastructure open call, it is about SSI architecture development. It's about open source SSI component development, agile development, integration, interoperability, and testing. So the subgrantees, which can be innovators starting from self-employed, university, startup, but also from larger companies. As a group, we are going to build this infrastructure using existing components, building new components, doing interop testing, doing plug testing. And we also have a liaison with the United States, with the Department of Homeland Services, which has a similar program. And maybe we are going to do even some of our plug testing together with them because they are developing something similar. The infrastructure call is open. And it will be in several rounds. It's a bit complicated algorithm, but you can see that on our website. So the output of the infrastructure open call, first of all, it will be SSI vision and architecture, which is input to the business open call number one. The business open call number one, this is where generic functionality is SSI functionality, software, services, products are developed. That was what you saw on the slide of Rieks, you know, the various components that you saw there. The business open calls, they are commercial and competitive in the sense that if you are a subgrantee, you must be a startup or SME. It is about new product development, new market development, and your product may be open source, but it may also be proprietary. The first business open call is about generic SSI functionality. So for instance, Rieks mentioned the revocation thing or the cryptographically enforced forced issuer policies. These are generic SSI functionalities that will be useful in many domains. Then the second business open call, which will be opened a bit later, these are about sector and application specific functionality. So if your startup or SME is active in the health sector, or maybe in the logistics sector, or in the governmental sector, and it's about administration, etc., then this is your open call. Again, this is commercial and competitive, and open source or proprietary is needed. And by the time the business open call starts, we will have enough infrastructure in place that the subgrantees of the business open call can use open source components made available through the infrastructure open call. So we see all kinds of feedback loops. The business open calls give market feedback to the infrastructure parties to see, okay, what we have built, does it work? Is it what is needed? And of course, products and services and customer feedback may also be exchanged between subgrantees, but this is something we'll discover probably during the process. This is an architecture picture. When you are one party, for instance, a consumer or a big enterprise, you will need all three types of functionality. You will need the holder functionality because others have issued verifiable credentials about you. For instance, that you are self-employed, SME, whatever. You may also be a verifier. If a consumer visits a website, then the consumer may want to verify what the website is, or the website may want to verify something from the other party. Maybe there are also issuer functionalities that parties want to issue things about people that they interact with. And of course, there is a wallet where everything is stored. So this whole infrastructure part is part of the infrastructure open call, and it will be all open source. Then on top of it, let's first look at the bottom, which is sort of out of scope. Of course, you need to have the underlying protocols to make sure that you have secure identified communication like SSL or maybe DID DID-based solutions, maybe something with blockchain, maybe something with ADAS. So whereas these are out of scope of the project itself, maybe bridges to those technologies will be in scope. So if you have a solution for strong authentication, that will be in scope for the infrastructure open call. Then on top, we see the business layer. The business layer has a generic part, which is about transaction validation, transaction dispatching, validation policies, issuing policies, transactions requests, transaction results, interactions, etc., which is generic functionality. That will be the focus of business open call number one. And then, of course, anything domain specific will be part of the business open call two. So I hope that this gives you a good view of how things relate. Of course, the development of this architecture, making it more precise, building components, parts of this will be part of the work of the open calls and the subgrantees, hopefully all of you. So as I mentioned, there is timing. The first business open call is already opened on the 1st of March. It closes on the 30th of April. I believe that because of the COVID-19 situation, there may be some extended deadlines, but I haven't heard a decision about that yet. So for the time being, please plan for the 30th of April. The infrastructure open call opens on the 1st of March, and it closes the 30th of June. But it is promised that it will not close before April 31st. So we are working with a funnel structure. So if you are applying to the business open call number one, then in your first month, you shall make a proof of concept plan and pre-financing, and you will get some money for this part. And some of the subgrantees, everything ends there. However, it's a funnel. Some of the subgrantees will get through, will start developing their, this was the infra. I think I have the infra and the business things switched. So this is a mix up. So this is probably the picture of the infrastructure where we have a funnel, a midterm review. And for the business-oriented program, we start with a hackathon period with proof of concept, business canvas, mock-up prototype, minimal viable product. And during this, there will be a lot of technical and business mentoring. And ultimately, it needs to a business plan, business case, and Also things related to fundraising, elevator pitches, things with investors will be part of this. So this gives you an overview and these numbers. The idea is that in the infrastructure call, we start with 10 sub-grantees and maybe during the course, maybe one or two or three will fall off. In the business open calls, our idea is to start with 21 sub-grantees and then the funnel will be pinching off much more steeply. But anyway, if you manage to the end of the infrastructure open call, there is up to €155,000 to be earned, and for the business open call, €106,000. So this was most of my presentation. Please go to the ESIF Lab homepage, which is esif-lab.eu. And from there, you can find the links to all the other documents. So to this presentation, but also to the vision and architecture. We have a GitLab repository, which will be filled during the whole course. And of course, the open calls themselves, you can find them there. So please make a note, esif-lab.eu, and from there you find everything. So that was my last slide, and I think the time has come for questions.
Absolutely, great. Thank you, Riggs. Thank you, Oscar. Questions? Yeah, we have plenty actually already coming in. I'll just bring them up as they came in, okay? And not all of them are directly related to the second part, but in between Riggs and you can then cover them, okay?
Sure.
So first comment coming here from Dan. Dan is asking, and this is from the presentation that Riggs was making in the beginning, and if the form requires biometric data and needs to be associated to the identity information with the actual person, that further complicates the process. And we need to contemplate assurance levels associated with identity proofing. And he's talking about IAL per NIST 863.3. I don't know, Riggs, you want to comment on this maybe?
Yes. Basically, there are two things here. The first thing is setting up a secure connection. Usually, authentication levels are being used in that context, but that needn't be. The second thing is about assurance levels for somebody, for a reference to a person, usually. That needs to be made certain that it is actually a precise reference to that person. The way we see this is that in the communication arena, we would very much like to see that components authenticate against one another to the level that there is some assurance that the component says, I've seen you before. And use this information to get the context of the owner, the owner of that connection, which usually would be the person, the user, or someone. But that can also be a business organization or a government. And this is. How do you say that? You can only get the context of somebody if you already have met that person or that organization, and if you have acquired data or information about this person or organization. And that is the second thing, basically. Any data or information you need from another can be gotten through credential type data that has been signed by whoever it is that you trust, because that's the those are the credentials that you will be asking. And basically this is the traditional way of how you get to know one another. If you in real life encounter somebody, then you can say, oh, I don't know you, and then you interact with each other. And as interactions proceed, then you get a better understanding, a better knowledge about who the other is. And also that accumulates the certainty, the assurance, and the trustworthiness of this other person. It's the same thing electronically. When doing business, you can use your experience with this other person because you have very strong cryptographic assurances that you are talking to the same person that you've been talking to before, and then use that to look up your interaction history, if you will, in terms of credentials that you have already received in terms of your own experience, stuff like that. So, in short, the assurance, I don't think that biometric data itself is something that you would see in forms, but rather you will see attributes that the business has specified that are relevant for its interactions, for its transactions that's going to negotiate with the other party. Of course, that might include biometric data, but typically I don't think that would be the case. Biometrics is much more for people that want to access an app that is under their own control, and that the app can then use to make sure that it is actually operated by its own user. That's a different thing. Not quite sure whether I addressed the question, but if not, then let's hear it.
Yeah, I would suggest the following. It seems to be special today because there's a big amount of questions. So maybe if we make the answers a little bit shorter, and you also have the contact details of Oscar and Riggs in the beginning. In the first slide, you will have the slide deck available at the SSI Meetup page. So just go to ssimeetup.org and you can check out all the emails and everything. And I just tell you the next questions because we have a long, long list of questions now. Okay.
Okay. Just from the procedural point of view, we have a frequently asked questions document. So whatever questions we don't get answered right now, Alex, please pass us the questions and we will make sure that we publish the answers there.
Okay, excellent. Okay, so here's just a out of curiosity question from Michelle. He's asking, you're showing projects in Toronto, Canada. Do you have projects currently running in Toronto?
No. I use this because when I was making the slide, it happened to be the first usable form for this slide that I could find when searching the internet on forms. That's it.
Okay. Great. And then we have Anil asking, will the slides be provided to attendees? Yes, if you just go to the ssimeetup.org and you check out webinar 52, which is this one, you have the slides actually already available right now in SlideShare and also in Google Slides, where you can download them and use them with a Creative Commons by Share Alike license, as we mentioned at the beginning. Then we have, make sure I get this right. Jürgen is asking, can universities work together with businesses, startups for the business open call?
I guess that is mine. The answer is yes, of course. And it's not only a question of can, but we expect this to happen. So we will have several subgrantees, and the whole point of the infrastructure open call is building components, but integrating and testing interoperability. So yes, there will be different subgrantees of different types. So there may be universities, there may be self-employed parties, and yes, we are expecting them to collaborate. if the question is, can we enter as a consortium? Then the answer is no. You can only enter as individual innovator, either on behalf of yourself or as a company, but not as a consortium, I think. At least also it would not make sense to enter as a consortium because the amounts are not that large.
Excellent. Okay, I'm just gonna continue going through the questions. Irene, she's asking, I would like to ask about the project description and application form. What level of detail does the project description of the infrastructure call require? What is expected? Can you please, just a sec, do a number, oh no, this is the next one already. So the question from Irene is, what level of detail does the project description for the infrastructure call require? What is expected?
Well, if you have, I can answer at least from the procedural point of view, and then maybe Riks from the technical point of view. From the procedural point of view, you will have a few blocks to enter with 1,000 letters. So how detailed can you be in 1,000 letters? Well, you should be sufficiently detailed that we understand your reputation, because one of the important things of the infrastructure call is that you're not a novice, that you're already active in the SSI area, that you already have code to offer, to integrate, etc. So that is an important requirement, but that's procedural. As for content, I'll leave the question to Riks.
Yeah, but that's leaning towards the procedural thing. Basically, there is this level playing field of these 1,000 characters in which you have to make sure that you come up as one of the better proposals that has impact and what are the other two again, Oscar?
Impact, organization, and well, content.
Yes. So the it doesn't. We don't need all the detail, all the gory details about cryptography or something like that. It is meant to be sufficient to be able to select the top so many that we need to go into the negotiations with for actually setting up a subcontinent agreement.
Okay. Next question coming from Didem. Didem is asking, can you please indicate what part in the infrastructure open call is out of scope? What is the logic to exclude parts?
Logic to exclude parts would be very basic technologies. For example, if you were doing algorithmic cryptography, that would end up in cryptography libraries, for example, as a contribution to Hyperledger URSA, for example, that would typically be out of scope. You see here in the underlying the SSI protocols and crypto layer, that is the blue layer on the bottom. It's just these hardcore, very objective technologies that would be out of scope. What would be in scope is if you can make these technologies worthwhile to be used in the business layer, because that is in the green SSI roles layer level. Yesterday, I had a discussion with somebody who was saying, well, how about signatures, a generic signature thing? You can put that in the bottom layer, and in fact, you can see it is here in the signing, it's in the middle of this SSI protocols and crypto layer. So if you were just doing the signatures, then that is out of scope. However, if you make it operational for businesses, that would mean that you would create a service that you can send a document or something to, and with a request of signing it for some specific purpose. That means that there is some business logic involved. That means that there is a business transaction here. And a generic SSI roles component for signing stuff in terms of business transactions. That would be, and that would include, for example, selecting the proper key. For example, a document that needs to be to hold up in court should be signed with an AIDAS signature, with a qualified signature. And if it is just something that isn't worth all that much, then you can use a self-generated key or something like that. Then, but if that is for the business and you can actually put it in this SF Blue API, then that would be inside scope. Does that answer the question?
Let's hope so. And we just keep on going. Okay, let me see to find the right question that is interesting for everyone. There's so many now. Here's something that might be interesting for other people. We are called Finema, based in Thailand, doing SSI DIDs, verifiable credential standards at the infrastructure layer. Can we apply for such grants, or how can we collaborate being here in the region of Asia Pacific?
I think that's mine. If you're from Thailand, then you cannot receive any funding. However, if you have something very interesting to offer, for instance, an SSI-based solution on the COVID-19, one of the COVID-19 issues, probably we can make our infrastructure and components available for you to contribute.
Excellent. Another question for Oscar. Is the aim of the calls to create a public accessible lab with a lot of testing tools and integrations, or is there a will to provide SSI services too? This is a question from Xavier.
So the aim of the project is to demonstrate that SSI has value to the European society. That is the ultimate goal. So the lab is to build the tools, the business open calls are there to use, and we hope that we launch some successful startups that are showing that you can use these tools, that you can make a useful business based on SSI, and that others follow our example. That is the ultimate goal, and of course the open source components are supportive to that.
And an associated goal is that we would like to create an ecosystem of developers at the various levels that will continue to develop the open source stuff after the project is gone.
Excellent. Audrius is asking, Hyperledger projects Indy, Aries, and Jerusalem have a lot of open source SSI related basic components. Do you plan any activities to not duplicate work that is already done by these Hyperledger projects?
Well, yes, in fact, we aim to not duplicate any work that is being done. Rather, we encourage applicants to use this stuff already and to contribute to improvements to these initiatives as part of what they're actually doing in SF Lab. And for SF Lab, the contribution would then be that this existing stuff, we would see more interoperability and scalability if that is necessary for this existing stuff. And that goes for any existing stuff, not just the Hyperledger things.
Excellent. And Xavier is asking also another question for Oscar. Who will be hosting and managing the ESSIF lab infrastructure for how long?
The party that is now hosting it is GRNet. They are the Greek, let's call them the university network. So, you know, I think the term is NREN, NREN. I don't know exactly what it means, but GRNet is hosting it. So if you click on the link sf-lab.eu, then if you click a bit through, you will get to the GitLab environment and you will see that it is grnet.gr as domain name. And as for what happens after the 3 years, hopefully we will have a basis to keep it everything existing. Of course, one of the options is donating all the open source to one or more of the Hyperledger projects.
Great. Kasper is asking, is it possible for partners to submit a proposal together? And do all the partners have to be EU-based?
The answer is no and yes. No, you can't submit together. Every partner needs to submit individually and every proposal will be looked at individually. Do you need to be a European party? Yes, you need to have you need to be eligible, which means that you need to be European.
Okay, just to clarify, because I'm not sure I got it right.
Okay.
When you say, is it possible for partners to submit a proposal together? I mean, what do you mean? Like, I mean, I understood that you can have multiple parties working together, like universities, startups, etc. But each of them needs to submit a project individually, even if it's the same project.
Let me clarify. Only single parties that are able to sign a contract with us can apply. So if you're five parties and we need to sign five contracts, then each of these are separate projects. Of course, if you start a joint venture, then the joint venture is a single entity and the joint venture can sign a contract with SF Lab.
Okay.
And of course, okay. You can do subcontracting.
Okay, so there's one contractually there's one counterparty and the rest of the and there will be subcontractors that are part of that project, but that can be then explained in the project proposal that other parties will be working with this, but there will be one single counterparty to do the project, right?
Correct.
Okay.
And that counterparty shall be a legal entity and not a consortium.
Excellent. Let me search more questions. I have a Greek name here that I cannot read, but it says, can a university research team make a proposal to the infrastructure call or only as are small and mid-sized companies valid? I think you answered this already, but maybe you want to comment.
The answer is yes, you are quite welcome to the infrastructure open call, which is open to any innovators, which can be university staff, self-employed individuals, employees of large companies. For the business open call, you shall be an SME or a startup.
Excellent. And Juan is asking, would new projects be also are new projects also considered for this, or only projects that already have started partially developed MVPs, etc.?
If you're a complete newcomer, you have nothing to show but good ideas and no reputation in the SSI arena, then your chances are probably low. On the other hand, if you are already working on some SSI software, you have software to donate, you are already working in a direction and you have some background, then that will increase your chances. And of course, it's our evaluators, which will be well-known names from the SSI arena, that ultimately decide how well your project scores on the three mentioned criteria.
I understood the question a bit differently. If you can demonstrate that you are already doing stuff within the SSE arena, and then you come up with a radically new idea for a radically new project, then that would be eligible. Well, of course, provided it meets the other requirements that are being set.
Okay. Audius is asking, could the same company apply for infrastructure and business calls at the same time? And the same question is being asked by Xavier again. He's asking, can a company apply to both infrastructure and business open calls? Can both be funded, awarded?
No. You can apply only to one. And if you apply to both, we will ask you which is the one that we should consider.
Okay. To clarify, is Hyperledger needed or favored? Hyperledger isn't unproblematic. from Veiko.
Neither. You can use Hyperledger, but if you use something else, then that's okay. A nice example is the Dutch initiative called IRMA. They don't use blockchain. They were there before Hyperledger ever started, so they don't use anything. But they do. They really do good stuff with attribute-based credentials, so that's perfectly okay.
Excellent. If you already participate in a H2020 funded SSI project, are you able to apply on an infrastructure call with a similar concept coming from Greece?
The answer is maybe. If you're already a subgrantee of the next generation internet, that may be a problem. I need to check this to make sure. So I am saying this with some uncertainty, but one thing that I can tell for you for sure is that we cannot pay, that is the European Union cannot pay twice for the same work. So if it's a different project, then probably it would work, but I'm not too sure. So please submit this to the frequently asked questions, and I have made a note that in the frequently asked questions, I need to answer this.
Okay, Sebastian is asking, and I'm not sure if this is a misunderstanding, maybe you can clarify, how will the hackathon be executed? Can you share any details?
Rix, can you say something about that? This is about the business open calls.
Yes, I'm not sure. I think, well, first of all, we have to think a bit how we will do that in the light of the coronavirus, because the first hackathon is scheduled for just after summer, and that may be a bit too soon. As for the second hackathon and in the second business open call, we haven't decided yet how that is going to do. So answer is, not sure.
But at least the purpose of the hackathon is that you demonstrate, you build and demonstrate your proof of concept.
Okay.
And this is for the business open calls. Yeah.
Excellent. Okay. Another question from Xavier coming in. Will there be any relation with what the European Commission is doing at EPSI level, European Blockchain Services Infrastructure, and also at European SSI framework?
The answer is yes. We have a liaison agreement with them, and we are planning to harmonize things related to architecture, etc. Also, we expect that parties that are already participating in the EPSI ESIF, that they may apply for subgrants to further enhance things that they are already working on.
Okay, Kasper is asking, you mentioned if you're outside the EU but have interesting solutions relevant to COVID-19, you may be able to open up the call. How should those parties contact you about this?
Maybe I was not completely clear. So you cannot apply for funding if you're outside the EU. However, you can make use of the components, and you can contribute to the open source process.
Okay, excellent. And another question from Kasper. How many proposals have you already received for the infrastructure and for the business calls?
The short answer is I don't know. I think it was several 10, but my colleague Ruud could tell me, but at this moment, I'm not sure whether he has a number for me.
Okay.
I can say something about that.
Ah.
The current status for the first business open call is that some 26 proposals are being worked on, as far as we can see. Only one has been actually submitted. And for the infrastructure open call, let me see, 21 have been started, but none have been actually submitted.
Okay, then I have the next, we have three left now. So this is a longer one. Oscar Riggs, first of all, thank you for your time and for putting this together. My name is Irene, founder at Gataka, an SSI technology provider based in Madrid. We have been working on the technology for 3 years now and have a working MVP that includes the four components, the SSI roles, layer, and market validation. We have two questions related to all this. How would you suggest we demonstrate our SSI expertise given our web repos are private for now? We can offer different components, but the application only has space for one component. What would be the best way to offer alternative components if that would be of interest to ESSIF?
I'm a bit confused by the apparent supposition that only one component could be contributed. That you can make a proposal for contributing more than one component. I don't have any issues with that. So I think whatever you find is the most useful to further the uptake and transition to the use of SSI technologies, that is something that you can propose, be it by not providing any components, but specifying or contributing, for example, to the specification of and the validation, of course, of interfaces like the SF glue layer that is still on the screen, or by contributing very many components. That's any contribution. So I'm a bit confused by the question, but I hope this does provide a bit of an answer.
Okay.
Also, if the answer is not clear, our email address is info@sf-lab.eu. And if we get the question frequently, then we add it to our frequently asked questions list.
Great. Last two questions here, unless someone else adds any other question. Does ENISA part of the project for certifying the secure vault components? In France, we have Coffre fort électronique standard that could be useful to widen for European certification, from Natalie.
So what is the question? I heard ENISA, I heard France, I heard the question mark, but I missed the rest.
Yeah, let me ask it again, because I mean, I hope you know ENISA. So does ENISA part of the project for certifying the secure vault components? I mean, I understand that the question is ENISA part of the project for certifying the secure vault components? Because in France, they have something called Coffre fort électronique, which is the standard that could be useful to widen European certification.
If there is a good way of securing these walls, like apparently in France is going on, then there is no you can contribute these things as a contribution into SF Lab if you actually add stuff, because for the additional stuff, that is what the grants are for. It's not the way we are thinking about the components is that we have many, you can have the same functionality in a component with different levels of security. So a coffre fort would have high security, but you can also have wallets which are inherently insecure. That's something we all want to accommodate. So if you have a contribution to make regarding secure wallets, then please do so.
Excellent. And Juan is asking, can individual contributors join the program before registering any company or already constituted SME will be considered?
Self-employed employees, self-employed people can contribute. We need to have a counterparty to sign the contract.
But can the counterparty be an individual or only legal entities?
Yes, an individual can be counterparty.
Okay, good. That should answer then the question for Juan. Then we have two more questions here. One from Ralph. Ralph, he's saying, there's a connection to, I have to read this in the chat, to A, what is this? There's a connection to AI. I think he means artificial intelligence. I understood that there's a relation to the Homeland Security Ministry of the USA. Is there also a relation to China regarding the fulfillment of international standards? Is it planned to create a certification company organization for identity products, like TÜV in Germany?
We would expect the certification and associated accreditation of various systems against various frameworks to be part of business open calls. We are not ourselves planning to create such frameworks. We're also not planning to actually have such certification organizations, but we do expect them to arise and then to also provide credentials in one way or another to the technical stuff that they have certified. And these credentials would then be usable within the context of this whole interoperable SSI framework.
Excellent. Then last question.
I have one addition that my colleague just pinged me about. There is the so we are NGI SF Lab, but there is also an NGI Atlantic project, and this is for cross-ocean collaboration between the US and Europe. So I heard mentioning of Department of Homeland Security, which is American. If you have any proposal that connects America, for instance, on the identity area with Europe, then you can apply for calls from NGI Atlantic, our sister project.
Excellent. Last question here from Kasper. Kasper is asking, with Gimli, I'm working on a piece of middleware, NFC cards that can sign transactions that could be used in SSI solutions. Will there be a platform where partners can see collaboration to submit proposals together?
Well, as the NGI SF Lab is for individuals or individual entities. So you can, if you are a joint venture, then you're a single legal entity and then you can sign. But I'm not really sure what is the questions about for partners.
Yeah, I think what he's trying to say is that somewhere where you can bring people together that might want to work on a project, but they don't have someone else they can work with. And so, I mean, his question is concretely, will there be a platform where partners can see collaboration to submit proposals together? So I think that means basically, okay, where other people say, hey, I'm interested, but I would like to propose something. Because I think that one of the understandings is that very often it's encouraged by the European Commission to have cross-European projects. So maybe some people think, hey, if we're from different countries working together on a proposal, even if there's just one single counterparty, would you provide a platform where these
people or companies can meet to provide something like that?
The short answer is I don't know. With the European Next Generation Internet Program, which is much larger than only NGI SF Lab, definitely there is something like that. There is the NGI Outreach Office, which is connecting lots of things together. Also, when you go to sflab.eu, we have a platform. I'm not really sure whether it is so. If your initiative is self-sovereign identity related, then this may be a platform. If it's in a more generic term, I believe the European NGI group has something like that, but I'm not sure. This should go to our frequently asked questions list.
Okay. Sebastian is asking, I think you answered this already, but I'm just asking because you guys, you're the experts, of course. So he's asking, can we apply to both calls, infrastructure and business at the same time? I understood that you said already that you have to choose one, right?
Choose one. And if you don't, we will choose for you. That is, we will just randomly select the one that you entered first and assume that the second one was sent in error.
Okay, okay. Irene is asking, can companies apply that receive money for a different project from NGI Ledger?
I don't think that, so this is about the double funding. European Union doesn't want to do double funding. So if you are wanting to have the same project extra funded from multiple NGI projects, I think the answer is no.
Okay, but she was specifically saying for different projects. So for different project, I understand it's unrelated then.
I'm just making a note. The short answer is I don't know where the boundary line is.
Okay. I think we covered all the questions. And we never had more questions, no more attendees. So that's good to see so much interest. Any final thoughts you would like to add, Oscar and Riggs, and recommendations?
Well, first of all, Alex, thank you very much for helping us organize this. It was great to have an audience of, at the peak, 100 participants. So we have really achieved an outreach thanks to SSI Meetup that alone we couldn't have done this well, this quickly. So thank you.
Yes, I
yeah. And of course, we are looking forward to receive many applications.
Yes, I will leave it with Oscar's words. So thank you.
Yeah, it's our pleasure. Actually, we had 100 because the limit is 101. I think there would have been more people that would have liked to join, but our platform never was pushed to the limit like this, like today. So that's good news. I think it's because people are excited about the opportunities for SSI in Europe. And I hope everyone takes up this opportunity to push SSI forward. I think, and we never talked about this at SSI Meetup before, but we might have to talk about it. I mean, we're seeing the United States really have been really strong in this space together with United States, Canada have been really strong. SSI has been really upcoming also in the last 12, 18 months in Europe. We also seeing that Korea is being pretty strong. I mean, strong all the time with public administration getting involved. Same trends also happening in New Zealand and Australia. But I think the biggest program we've seen so far in terms from the public administration is coming, the one coming from the European Commission and the European Union. So that's really good. And I think is one of the transformational technologies and exponential technologies for the future that is really showing its importance right now in this COVID situation we have. And SSI will be really, really strong. So I'm really happy that Oscar and Riggs, that you're pushing forward on this. If you want to learn more about SSI meetups, please just join the newsletter that you can sign up for on the website. You will have access to the presentation, the video and the slideshow upcoming today. Just check out the same link where you signed up here on the website. And you can also follow us on Twitter, Facebook, LinkedIn, and the Telegram group we have. I think those are all the channels. Our next webinar will probably be about the new protocol coming up from Freebox based in New York. And we will have many more coming up in the future. And that's, I think, that's it for today. Thank you so much, everyone. Thank you so much, Weeks and Oscar. You're always invited again to talk more about this and all the other things that you do in the SSI space. And I really hope that the European Union will put the whole region on the map for the SSI space. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Goodbye.
Bye.
Yes, thank you.